This week, a judge will consider whether Congresswoman Marjorie Taylor Greene should be allowed to run for reelection based on her actions surrounding the January 6th insurrection. After an at times contentious hearing, there's another question. Did she perjure herself on the stand under oath? This is one of the moments in question.
In fact, you think that Speaker Pelosi is a traitor to the country, right?
I'm not answering that question. It's speculation.
You've said that, haven't you, Ms. Green, that she's a traitor to the country?
No, I haven't said that.
Okay. Put up Plaintiff's Exhibit 5, please.
Hold on now. I believe by not upholding the securing the border, that violates her oath of office.
Fair enough. I'm not interested in her oath of office. I'm interested in that you said that she's a traitor to our country.
Joining us now is Andrew Celli, the attorney who questioned Congresswoman Greene on the stand. Counselor, thank you so much for being with us. Do you believe the Congresswoman committed perjury while you were questioning her, and do you intend to make a referral?
Well, the question of perjury is really for other people to decide, and most importantly for Judge Boudreau down in Atlanta to decide. He has to find the facts here. But I will say it stretches credulity that this woman can make these kinds of statements, make them publicly on her Facebook page in front of her hundreds of thousands of Facebook followers and the millions of people who view her comments all the time, and then claim she doesn't remember. It's shocking to me.
Well, let me play that, because you're referring to something more than what I just played there. She used the "I don't recall, I don't remember" several times. Let's listen.
You didn't talk to anybody in government about the fact that there were going to be large protests in Washington on January 6th.
I don't remember.
You spoke to Representative Biggs or his staff about that fact, didn't you?
I do not remember.
How about Representative Gosar?
I'm sorry, I don't remember.
Did anyone ever mention to you the possibility that there might be violence in Washington?
I don't remember.
Now, I do hear you when you say it'll be up for the judge to decide, but what do you think? What's your take on how much she remembers?
Well, look, this is a developing situation, and our work in Georgia was really just part of trying to enforce the Constitution. The 14th Amendment to the Constitution forbids someone who engaged in insurrection from standing for election to federal office. That's essentially what we're trying to do. There are other investigations. There's a federal investigation. There's a congressional investigation. And this story has not played out yet. In fact, what we saw Friday is that after the close of our hearing, there were more filings in federal court that would have been enormously helpful to us had we known about them on Thursday. But that's the way history develops, and I think we have to wait and see.
The key word you use there on the 14th Amendment is engaged in insurrection, or aids in insurrection. It's different, as you know, and I'm sure you would argue before the court, than speech. Using speech, even inflammatory speech, engaging in insurrection can be different from that. So I guess I want to know from you, what do you think the one action, if there was one or more than one action there was, specific action she committed that constitutes engaging in insurrection?
On January 5th, the day before the insurrection, Congresswoman Greene told her followers on her Facebook page on a national broadcast that tomorrow is 1776. Now, that's the kind of rhetoric that, you know, we all can talk about historical references and so on, but in the context that she was dealing with it, where people understood that 1776 was code for break into the Capitol, do violence, and most importantly, block the certification of Joe Biden, that is an act of insurrection, and we demonstrated and proved
the 1776 is.
Yes.
Even if the judge makes a recommendation, which, look, the judge didn't seem to be inclined to, but who knows, makes a recommendation for this case to proceed, Brad Raffensperger, the Secretary of State in Georgia, will be the one to decide the next step. Now, yes, you know, he would not engage in the shenanigans that Donald Trump was asking him to, but do you think he'll take your side?
I believe in the processes of government. I mean, Secretary of State Raffensperger is going to have to decide this issue, and then there will be court appeals. This will go to the Georgia Supreme Court ultimately. And there's partisanship in our country, that's very clear, but I have committed my life as a lawyer to the belief that the rule of law will prevail in the end, and I think we have the rule of law on our side.
Andrew Celli, counselor, thank you for being with us this morning. I appreciate it.
Joining me now is CNN editor-at-large and politics reporter Chris Cillizza. Chris, great to see you. So based on Raffensperger's actions in the past, what's the outlook for Greene here and really for Trump in this state?
Yeah, so I think it's important that we separate out what Raffensperger did in 2020 versus what we're talking about here. So in 2020, the question was Donald Trump calling Brad Raffensperger and saying, I need you to find effectively 11,000 votes so that I can win the state. Raffensperger refused. That's why Donald Trump has endorsed Jody Heiss, a congressman who is running against Raffensperger in the Georgia primary. Let's put that in a bin. That was Raffensperger quite clearly standing up to Donald Trump's unlawful attempt to overturn the election results in Georgia. This is a lot more unclear legal ground. So as you mentioned, this based on the 14th Amendment, this is a provision put in post-Civil War to deal with treason. The issue here, and why you heard Marjorie Taylor Greene say, I don't know so many times, is the issue is intent, Bianna. That's the question in terms of proving it. Can you prove that she knew violence was likely, that she encouraged violence? She's going to say, and she did over 50 times, some version of I don't know or I can't remember, because it's hard to prove intent. And remember, even if the judge recommends that she be removed from the ballot, Raffensperger, who I'll remind people is a Republican, just like Marjorie Taylor Greene, they may be on different ends of the spectrum, but still in the same party, he has the ultimate authority to decide this. So the judge cannot rule her off the ballot. It's up to the Secretary of State.
Yeah, and then she, of course, whatever that ruling would be, she could appeal as well.
Yes.
Right. Chris Cillizza, this is a long process. Thanks for helping explain it for us. Well, here with me now is Patricia Murphy, political reporter for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. Patricia, great to see you. So we know that former President Trump still plays a significant role in Georgia politics. I'm just curious, what do you think the long-term implications are here for Raffensperger and also Greene?
Well, the short-term implications for Brad Raffensperger is that he has his own primary coming up on May 24th, and that primary is against Representative Jody Heiss, who is a stop the sealer, one of the Republicans in Washington who worked to overthrow the Georgia election results. So he has his own short-term political survival at stake here, but I think also he is a man who has shown that his own political survival is not paramount in his decision-making process. Otherwise, he would have gone in a different direction during the 2020 election. So long-term, we'll have to see what he does with this. We need to first see what the judge recommends to him in the meantime.
How about Greene?
I think for Marjorie Taylor Greene, this won't make a dent in her support in the 14th congressional district among the Republicans who support her. That is an extremely conservative Republican district. And the people who are with her are also with Donald Trump. Donald Trump is the most popular Republican in Georgia right now. And so she has aligned herself closely with him and with his causes. And if you're in an extremely conservative district and you need to just get through your primary first and then a general election, I really don't think this is going to change people's minds about her. They've known this about her, that she had a lot to do with standing in the way of the election. And this, I think, just reinforces that for better or for worse for Georgia voters.